Hi, amazing people. Welcome once again to your favorite girl, Princess Gitum, Queen of Hearts and Laughter. You're welcome once again. It's a card. It's a chapter a day to keep you going, to keep you soaked in the word, so that your lives can be transformed and changed to the glory of God. And you can be able to live the Christian life successfully in this our generation till the end. So let's get to what we have today. The first things we'd always do is to read our birthday people and wish them a very special happy birthday. So today is the birthday of Ma'am Mona Franca Bright, Ma'am Kawa Moni, Ma'am Agbo Audrey, Ma'am Acho Mercy, and Senor Ki Flavi. Well, that's Ma'am Nyoki Flavi, Flavine. Okay, so happy birthday to the five girls, to the five ladies, amazing women. God bless you and give you long life and make everything good come your way in Jesus' name. And like I said, every single day in January, we're definitely going to be saying Happy New Year. And if we remember to say it sometime in February, March, April, May, that's fine too. But January is the start of the year for a lot of people. And so I'm going to say Happy New Year and glad tidings. And like we said, we're not going to be talking so much at the start of the video. We'll talk more at the end when we're done reading the scripture. So let's get this started. Matthew chapter 27. Today is the 27th day of January. Matthew chapter 27 actually has 66 verses. So it's going to be a long read like yesterday. But we are well able and we're going to do this. Matthew chapter 27. When the morning was come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have seen in all that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? See thou to that. And he cast down the 30 pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself. And the chief priest took the silver pieces and said, it is not lawful for to put them into the treasury, because it is it's the price of the blood. And they took counsel and bought with them the potter's field to bury strangers in. Wherefore that field was called the field of blood until this day. Then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Jeremy the prophet, saying, and they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of him that was valued, whom they of the children of Israel did value, and gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord appointed me. And Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, saying, art thou the king of the Jews? And Jesus said unto him, thou sayest. And when he was accused of the chief priests and elders, he answered nothing. Then said unto Pilate him, hearest thou not how many things they witness against thee? And he answered him to never a word, insomuch that the governor marveled greatly. Now at that feast the governor was wont to release unto the people a prisoner whom they would, and they had then a noble, notable prisoner called Barabbas. Therefore, when they were gathered together, Pilate said unto them, whom will ye that I release unto you, Barabbas or Jesus, which is called the Christ? For he knew that for envy they had delivered him. When he was set down on the judgment seat, his wife sent unto him, saying, have thou nothing to do with that just man? For I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said unto them, whether of the twain will he that I release unto you? They said, Barabbas. Pilate said unto them, what shall I do then with Jesus, which is called the Christ? They all said unto him, let him be crucified. And the governor said, why? What evil had he done? But they cried out more, saying, Let him be crucified. When Pilate saw that they could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See ye to it. Then answered all the people and said, His blood be on us and on our children. Then released he Barabbas unto them. And when he had scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall and gathered unto him the whole band of soldiers. And they stripped him and put on him a scarlet robe. And when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head and reed in it. And reed in his right hand, and they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews. And they spit upon him and took the reed and smote him on the head. And after that they had mocked him, they took the robe off from him and put his raiment on him and led him away to crucify him. And as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name, him they compared to bear his cross. And when they were come unto a place called Golgotha, that is to say, a place of a skull, they gave him vinegar to drink, mingled with gall. And when he had tasted thereof, he would not drink. And they crucified him, and parted his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet. They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots. And sitting down, they watched him there. And set up over his head his accusation written, This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Then were there two thieves crucified with him, one on the right and another on the left. And they that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads, and said, Thou that destroyed the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself. If thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross. Likewise also the chief priests mocking him with the scribes and elders said, He saved others, himself he cannot save. If he be the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusted in God, let him deliver him now. If he will have him, for he said, I am the Son of God. The thieves also, which were crucified with him, cast the same in his teeth. Now from the sixth hour there was darkness all over the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Some of them that stood there, when they heard that, said, This man called for Elias. And straightway one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with vinegar and put it on a reed and gave him to drink. The rest said, Let be, let us see whether Elias will come to save him. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of the graves, after his resurrection, and went into the holy city, and appeared unto many. Now when the centurion and they that were with him, watching Jesus, saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, Truly, this was the Son of God. And many women were there, beholding afar off, which followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering unto him, amongst which was Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's children. When the evening was come, there came a rich man of Arimathea, named Joseph, who also himself was Jesus' disciple. He went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be delivered. And when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out in the rock. And he rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulchre and departed. And there was Mary Magdalene and the other Mary sitting over against the sepulchre. Now, the next day that followed the day of the preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, Sir, we remember that that deceiver said, While he was yet alive, after 3 days I will rise again. Command therefore that the sepulchre be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come back by night and steal him away, and say unto the people, He is risen from the dead. So the last error shall be worse than the first. Pilate said unto them, He have a watch, go your way, make it as sure as he can. So they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. Hi, amazing people. Let's see those who are here. This is Matthew chapter 27. We just read, and we have five people in the house, but I don't know who are here, but I know Sir Raymond Henry is here. My very own uncle, Ni Divine Chamokong, is here. Thank you for coming. And it's a chapter a day to keep you going, to boost your faith, to help you grow, to help you get soaked in the word so that your focus will be right. Sir Charles Bentulonji. Oh my God, Sir Lonji Charles, happy ages, like forever. This is like forever. Okay, so this is a chapter a day. We call it ACAD. We read a chapter of the scripture every single day. This is going to take us about 3 years from my estimation. And so I'm sure you all are going to ride on with me. So it's like, you're going to be seeing this my face every single day. You would have to get used to me being in your faces all the time. Okay, so I just had an assignment to read the Bible, to make an audio Bible that is done by me. I know God has beyond just reading the Bible. So I believe that whatever he has in store for whoever is going to be listening to this is bigger than me. It's way bigger than all of us who are here present, way bigger than all of us who are partaking or participating in this whole assignment. Let me call it like that, because that's the easiest way to call it, and it's an assignment for all of us. So on Facebook, right here on my platform, we actually read the Bible and then we say our lessons learned. We kind of do a little bit of rundown of what we've learned from the scripture, and you can also chip in. You can also say what you've learned if you're reading with us, or if you read a long time before you came on here today. So we always put that out so that you can also come on. You can request to come live and we'll put you on, and then you'll be able to talk. Oh, Sir Raymond Henry says, Princess, keep up the good work. Thank you so much. Thank you for always coming. So let's get to our lessons learned today. I'm feeling like so hot today. The weather just changes here all of a sudden. Today is hot and tomorrow is just very cold. Okay. And so this is what I wanted to say it yesterday, but I realized that we're going to read it today. So I wanted to bring it to today. So from the start of the scripture is showing the difference between Peter and Judas Iscariot. I wanted to talk about the difference. They've not yet told us about, they've already told us about Peter's option, where Peter, after denying Jesus 3 times, he realized his mistake. He went and cried himself out and he repented. And this is Judas, because most times when a lot of people talk about Judas, they talk about him as if he did not repent. Yes, he's in hell for a different reason, not because he did not repent. He didn't only repent, he repented and restituted. What is restitution? Restitution is that time when you do something wrong to somebody, or you take something from somebody that is not yours. And then when you repent and you come to Christ, you have to go give that thing back. You have to go apologize. You have to go make things right with that person. That's what restitution is. So he repented, as we can see, and he went to the chief priest and gave the money back. He repented and gave them the money back. That was repentance and restitution. Total and completely what God desires. There are lots of Christians who repent, but they don't restitute. It's a different ballgame entirely. If the person is not available, if you can't have access to the person, that's another ballgame entirely. It's a different thing if the person is dead or you just can't get to the person. That's a different ballgame entirely. But if that person is still on planet Earth, trust me, I know it's very humiliating. I know it's very difficult, but it is required of children of God that when you repent, you restitute. And restitution is apologizing for a wrong that you did. Maybe you accuse someone falsely and the person got into trouble. Yes, the person has been set free now. Yes, but you still need to go and apologize to the person and tell them that this thing I said about you was false. So I've come to apologize. Please forgive me. The part of the person forgiving you or not is not of your business. You don't have a responsibility as to how the person reacts to your apology. All you have a responsibility is to make things right. Because when you make things right with that person, you've made things right with God. God requires restitution. So Judas didn't go to hell because he sinned, because he betrayed Jesus. He went to hell because he committed suicide and he hung himself. That's what the Bible said. That is it. Jesus does not allow suicide. God does not allow you killing yourself. So that's the reason why. When I was depressed, I had a lot of suicidal thoughts. And it's just because I know that all murderers, all this and that, they're going to spend the rest of their life in hell. I know, as I know for sure, with reading through scriptures and stuff, that hell is worse than any pain any human being will ever feel on earth. It is worst. I mean, like, worst, totally. So when that thought kept coming to my head, if you're doing this, you're taking an express ticket to hell, I didn't commit suicide, I would have been history today. You'd have been hearing there was a certain girl that was called because I was depressed and I had suicidal tendencies. I was thinking, like, lots of times. But when I start thinking, this whole thing keeps coming to my mind. If you kill yourself, you're going to spend eternity in hell. And it's worse than whatever you're going through now. So I know that the pain is there. I know that the pain is so hard. You can't give up now. Even if you decide to give up, darling, you just can't commit suicide. Because you know where you're going to go to. That's how it helped me. So that guy, Judas Iscariot, did things right. But he went further. And that's the reason why we always say, let God give us the grace not to fall, because you might fall and not come back. Peter fell and he came back. Judas fell and he couldn't come back. Because sometimes the guilt can so overshadow you, can so overpower you, and then it makes you do those stupid things like committing suicide. The pain so overpowers your mind, it so crowds your reasoning that you just think the only thing is to ease the pain and dying is the safest and the best option. But what about after death? There is life after death. Where would you spend eternity? Here is just a time frame. Time is limited. Eternity is forever, forever. So think it again. Think about it. Sometimes we only see the results of how people committed suicide, but we forget that it's accumulated pain that is making them to take that action. They didn't just wake up that beautiful morning and just committed suicide. No, they have been in pain, accumulated pain. So next time when you're talking to someone, when you're treating someone, be careful, because you don't know what people are going through. One word from you might just get somebody to commit suicide. One word from you can just make someone to change their mind from committing suicide. So life and death are in the power of the tongue. Think and think again before you speak. If you know it's not going to build, if you know it's not going to make progress, if you know it's not going to be good, better don't speak. Don't even say it. Don't even say it. Don't give life to it. We give life to the things that happened. Most of the things that are happening to us today are an accumulation of the things we've said before today. So what are you going to be saying today for your tomorrow? If Christ tarries to come, though. If you didn't like your yesterday, then fix it today. So that when you get into tomorrow, you look at your yesterday, you're going to love it. I did great. We look at the back just to see how far we've come. But let's be careful. Even my exclamations are godly and people are like, I'm overdoing it. Yes, people of the world overdo it. Why should I not overdo it for my God? Like, are you kidding me right now? I've been in the world. And when I was in the world, I was all out. And so now that I'm in Christ, I am all out, people. If you ain't good with it, make your choice. We are supposed to choose who is supposed to be our friends and stay our friends. We're supposed to choose. And it's a conscious choice. So if you come and you see someone has some values and some rules and regulations that you don't work with, click, click, you can. I'm not saying this to be mean. I'm saying it as a truth. Because a lot of times we try to keep people close to us. We try to keep people in our lives that are taking us down. They're taking us out of the Christian race. They are actually making the word of God to get diluted in our minds. And then by the time you notice, you're living for the world instead of for God. So that part, when we actually sin and we repent, we need to restitute. Judas did that. He failed. He repented, he restituted, but he went way beyond because he couldn't handle the torment. He couldn't handle the thoughts that he had betrayed an innocent person. That's why we need to pray for grace so that we don't get to sin before trying to come out, because it is risky. You just might sin and that's the end of it. You might not have an opportunity like Peter. You might have an opportunity like Judas, but you might end up doing something stupid, which will not lead you to eternity with Christ. And Christ doesn't want that. I don't want that too. Nobody wants that. Okay? And then it went further to say that we need to live a life as a Christ life, as Christians. We need to live our lives so much so that when people look for things to accuse us of, they won't find any. Let it be that you're being accused for Christ's sake, because it's false accusation. Let it not be that you are truly. And the truth is, most of us, some of us, even us Christians, we are accused for real things. Like, we are really guilty of the things. This is Jesus here. Everybody was looking for something to get to him. They couldn't see it. Even Pilate, who was the perfect judge, had to go through Jesus' case and found nothing that he was guilty of. But the people said, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. My darling, my dearest, my royalty, people will accuse you falsely even when you're right. You know what Jesus did? Jesus never responded in some cases. Some places he responded, some places he was just quiet and people marveled. Because he didn't want to say something that was going to push him to the wall. He didn't want to say something that people are going to hold on. Because that's what our generation is all about. Most of the times people push you and push you and push you. And then you say something, they deviate from the original problem and go to what you said. They deviate from the original problem and go to how you're saying what you said. They deviate from the original problem and say you're being rude. And say you're shouting. And say you're doing this or doing that. That's what is happening in our generation. And that's why problems hardly ever get solved. Because if we move from the original problem and we're not solving it and we're trying to solve a reaction or a fruit of the problem, then we'll never solve the problem because the problem is going to repeat itself shortly after. That's exactly what happened. So these people kept giving false accusations and false accusations against Jesus. As long as you're a child of God and you're standing for Christ, people are going to accuse you falsely sometimes, but there is really nothing you can do about it. Until the truth be the truth, there's just nothing you can do about it. People are going to make mockery of you. People are going to push you. This is Jesus. He could save himself, right? He could save himself. He could have just called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he went alone to set us free. But he went alone to the cross to set us free. Yes, Jesus could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he went alone to the cross to set us free. But he went alone to the cross just for my sakes. Oh, how lovely my God is. You know, there are sometimes people are going to push you. They're going to challenge you. You know there are things you can do. And they're going to be telling you, oh, he says he's the Son of God. He has saved people. He can't save himself. You know those kind of provocative talks? The devil is just pushing you and choking those thoughts and pushing those thoughts and shooting those shots in your head so that you should do something stupid. But Jesus was too wise to know that. He had a mission on earth and he wasn't going to minor on the major and major on the minor. So each time they kept doing all that, he was focusing on the glory that was set before him. And he endured the cross and took the shame. And there was the glory. His name is the name above every other name. He didn't just sit and it was brought to him on a platter of gold. He had the option to do that. Jesus would have sat in heaven and decided with the Trinity on what to do to save the world without him lifting a finger, without him coming to earth. But he had to feel what we feel to know that we can truly live on earth here and get saved by our choice and decisions. Not being puppeted, not being pushed, not being pressured, but you making a singular decision to accept Christ. Sorry, people, that gets to happen sometimes because my phones are all having the same thing, so the call there. That's what happens. That's what happens, people. So you need to make the choice. You need to take the stand. So there are some times that people are going to push you. They're going to challenge you. Yes, if you claim that you're this, then do this. If you know that you're this, then do this. If you know that you're a child of God, then prove God to us. You have no point proving God to nobody. God is God. Whether people believe it or not, some people will just argue the Bible with you for argument's sake, not because they really want to learn. There are lots of people like that. So know when. Pray for God for the spirit of discernment to know when someone truly wants to know about God and when someone just wants you to quarrel or someone just wants you to argue so you get your spirit grieved. Know the difference. Jesus knew the difference. He knew when he would be quiet. He knew when he was going to talk and all that. And then the tearing of the veil. The tearing of the veil had to do with giving us direct access to God. A lot of times we're so lazy. We want the man of God, the woman of God. We want our elders or our leaders to do everything for us. But Jesus made access to us. Before, it was just the priests who go into the holies of holies and do the thing for everybody and stand the gap for everybody between him and God. And there were just some things he couldn't do. Only him could do, no other person. But when Jesus died on the cross, he made it possible for you and I to walk into his presence boldly, to obtain mercy and grace, to get into the holy of holies, to get direct access. Let me give the picture. Let me give the scenario. Let me give the scenario. So this is Jesus. He has given you access to his Father. And he says, you can just come to the house and go directly. This is where my Father is. He has told me to come and tell you that he's in the parlor. He's in the house. He's in the living room. So just go and meet him directly. And then you come again and probably meet Jesus outside. And then you're like, Jesus, can I go in? Or maybe you just come and meet maybe the gardener, maybe an angel standing outside guarding the house. And then you're like, please help me tell God that I really need this. Does it even make sense? It doesn't make sense. You have the power. You've been given the access and the ability. You know where God is. You can go directly to him. What would it make sense if you're trying to put people in the middle, if you're trying to get to God through people again? No, it doesn't make sense. It makes no sense. It makes no single sense at all. There is no excuse anybody can give for why they can't get direct access to God. You can. Jesus made that possible. When the veil of the temple was torn into two, it was because Jesus was giving us the access that we need to the throne room of heaven. That was it. So please, let's stop this papa mama thing. Let's have a personal relationship with God. At some point, we read in previous chapters, Jesus was asking, oh, this one said, what do people say I am? They said, this one said, oh, you're this, you're that, you're that. And he finally ended up asking the most important question, who do you say I am? You need to get to that point where someone asks you, who is Jesus to you? You can give them an answer. You can give them a reasonable answer, a qualitative response, not because you just mastered it, not because you read the Bible, not because you did theology, but because you have a personal experience and a personal relationship with God. So when you're talking about it, you're unapologetic. When you're talking about it, you are straight and I mean, like you hit the nail on the head. Because you know it's an experience. It's not just literature. It's not, oh my God, my Father, my Father, my Father. When you have an experience with God, you will be unashamed to talk about him. We are ashamed to talk about Christ sometimes because we're still living a lie. Sometimes our lives are not actually Christ-like, so we're worried about what the people will think. Why people, some people say, oh, this one claims she's godly, and look at what she's doing, and that and that. It's because our lives are not straight. But when you have a straightforward life, you'll be doing things like Jesus was doing, and people will find all kinds of accusations. I remember Daniel in the Bible as well. They had to find all kinds of errors in his doing, in his lifestyle, in what he was saying. They could not find. So they had to twist things just to get him in trouble. But when people keep twisting things, you'll get vindicated, because the truth always prevails. Okay? And so they made all those jokes. Like I said already before, that a lot of things are happening in the scripture because the Bible had to be fulfilled. So some of the things were happening and you think like, but why did this one have to happen? Why did they let this happen? Jesus would have just made it, you know, go away. When a prophecy comes out, it has to get fulfilled. Even if it's a negative prophecy, it would get fulfilled. Except you pray against it. That's one. And then you walk towards it and you get to be conscious so much so that when it comes to the time, you'll be able to overcome it. That's what happens. But if, like Peter, you didn't pray when Jesus was praying, you'll deny him 3 times. If the challenges come and you didn't pray, you didn't prepare spiritually before the physical manifestation, because sometimes you so prepare in the physical that it doesn't even manifest in the spiritual. That's how it gets to be. Hello, Ma'am Ira Destiny. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you for coming. So there are lots of scriptures that are going to be fulfilled in the Bible, and some of them are not good, but pray that you don't be the person who is fulfilling the negative scriptures in the Bible. Pray that you don't be the one who is fulfilling the negative scriptures in the Bible. And there was one part here that I saw and I wanted to say, so some people are going to crucify you for things that you didn't do. Some people are going to accuse you for things that you didn't do. They did it to Jesus. They'll do it to us. We're no different. We're no different. Okay. And there was one more here. Sorry, people. I saw one thing here and I got it in my heart to say. Yeah, there's sometimes as well that people would say things like that. Even Jesus felt the pain. Like I said, sometimes we feel like, oh, we should be in denial. We're feeling pain. We're feeling the anger. We're feeling bad that people are accusing us falsely and all. Jesus felt some level of pain. Even here, it was there. And even here, he says, why have you forsaken me? There are times in our lives that we feel like God has forsaken us. But he knows that we need to endure that cross to get the glory. So he's not going to lift the finger. He's going to let you go through that thing. So when you come out, you'll be giving testimonies and glory unto his name. Some people already in this scenario started seeing from the things that were happening. And they said, this is truly the Son of God. Can you really stand for God? So much so that people see that this is the child of God. This is a daughter of Zion. This is a son of Zion. Can you really stand? Even if it means you stand alone. A lot of people were making fun. And then there are some people who are kind of hidden disciples. Some people were hiding, you know, like the one who came and took Jesus to go and bury him and all that. You know, yeah, so that happened. And yes. Okay, so I think that will be it for today. So we've learned a lot from this lesson. We've learned that when you sin and you repent, you need to restitute. But we pray that God should help us not to even sin at all, so that we don't get to the point where we're so embarrassed to go for restitution. Welcome, said Tabby Clinton. My almost namesake, almost, because mine is Clinton, not Clinton. Okay, and we need to restitute, but we pray for grace that we don't even sin, because sometimes we realize that some of the torments that come with the sin, with the scars of sin, they can lead us to depression. depression. They can lead us to suicide. They can lead us to really crazy things, and we might lose it. And then we also learn that people are going to persecute us even for things that we didn't do. People are going to lie about us. People are going to challenge our faith in many ways. We should know when to react and when not to react. We should know when to let God and not do it ourselves. And we also learned here that a lot of things have to be fulfilled in the scripture, and because they have to be fulfilled, make sure you're not the one who is fulfilling the negative scriptures. And I don't know if some other person had another lesson they learned, you'd have put it in the comment section and we'll be able to give you a shout out. I always say that if you by any chance have your birthday, you can let us know and we'll put it in our birthday booklet, and we can say hello to you sometime. When we're on here, we can say Happy New Year to you. We can say Happy Birthday to you, because we only read the names from our birthday booklet. So we can't say Happy Birthday to you when we don't have your name. So Happy Birthday to all those who were born today. We wish you all the very best and God bless you. And like I said, you always have this on my other social media platforms, especially YouTube, just the edited version. But right here on Facebook, my personal account, you have the Bible read out and lessons learned. It's Akkad with your favorite girl, Princess Clinton, Queen of Hearts and Laughter. But mind you, our signature remains Queen of Hearts and Smiles. So when you see it written anywhere, it will be Hearts and Smiles. But when I'm saying it, it's going to be Laughter. We upgraded in 2021, okay? So if you're surprised, that's why. And thank you for being here. Also get to share, like, and subscribe. Follow us on all our social media platforms, IG, Facebook. We have a Facebook page. We have an IG page. We also have a YouTube channel. Follow us on all our social media platforms if you like what you see there. And also get to share. We'll really be grateful. So each time we upload a new video, you'll be the first to know. And you'll also be able to know that we're live, like now, when we go live. Thank you all for being here so much. I always get to say I love you so, so very much. But God loves you way, way more. Bye-bye. Until tomorrow, you can read Matthew chapter 28 and bless someone in the comment section, or you come live too. Mwah.